LTC brown bag. And this month, we will have Dylan Selterman. And he's going to present the Fast Friends, a scientific icebreaker. So informal venue. So if you have questions, you know, raise your hand. And hope you enjoy the presentation.
Thank you. And yeah, let me emphasize that again. If anything strikes you or if you have any questions, then feel free to interrupt. This is fluent. Last semester I did have a class around this size, but that was an anomaly. We had normally not that small. So I want to talk about the Fast Friends procedure. This is something that was developed by Art Aaron and his colleagues in the late 90s. And he was one of my mentors in graduate school. That's why I'm especially familiar with this method. But let me just give a little bit of an introduction. So our goals here are to facilitate student learning and engagement. And we know that these pedagogical goals will be improved when we have students that feel free to communicate with instructors, with their TAs, with other students. We want them to ask questions. We want them to participate. We want them to be active learners. And we also know that learning is a fundamentally social process. The way people learn, that's why we're here. That's why we're not all at home on our computers, you know, just digging up information randomly. We learn from other people. We learn with other people. And a lot of what we do in school, a lot of what students do is going to be group focused, group outcomes and projects. We're also thinking that, you know, students are going to be relying on each other. Even if they don't have a specific project or task they're working on together, they're still going to be feeding off each other in terms of social support and in terms of teamwork, study groups, all kinds of things in environments in which students will work together. And also, you know, students are here not just to learn, but to network, to meet each other and to get involved and to form groups. So for all these reasons, it's especially important to get students talking from day one. Every time a new semester starts, get them talking. So the solution to this, you know, issue, to this task we're trying to manage to get students talking, in a lot of cases, teachers will use icebreakers. Now, I would like to actually get your feedback here and tell me if you've ever used an icebreaker activity in any of your experiences, and what was that like, either as a student or a teacher? Any type of experience with an icebreaker activity? Oh wait, I'm sorry, say it again.
Sorry, as a student, I hated them. And then someone organizing, I worked with high school students during the summer, and I designed the icebreakers, and I tried very hard. And they were all good sports about it, and they still hated them.
So what kinds of things were you doing? What was the activity?
The team building games. So you have the ones where you have to have the circle in the hands. You know what I'm talking about?
Okay.
Yeah, there's that one. There's the telephone game. There's the you gotta get everyone on the same square of carpet game where you keep taking away squares of carpets.
Okay.
You know, have you seen that one?
I don't think I have. It sounds interesting.
Everyone having their own square of carpet, and then you slowly take away carpet like squares until everyone has to be off the floor.
Okay.
At all times. So
okay.
You have to get used to problem solving.
Okay.
Pieces of carpet.
All right. Yeah. That. Yeah. Let's hear some more. Yeah.
I work over at the Stamp Student Union, and they do a ton of icebreakers in their training and those things. And I was not very excited about them when I started, but they did a lot more casual, like personality focused, tell us about yourself type of things.
Right. Right. Right.
And then the anxiety level about it came down a little bit because you didn't feel so much like you were being evaluated.
Sure. So. Sure. Sure. Good. Any others? Yeah.
Well, I teach an online class at the community college. And this is like a prerequisite to get into the medical programs. It's a medical terminology one credit class. I had people who were like, and the first, they tell you to do an introductions form. The first time I did, I said, tell me about yourself.
Mm-hmm.
They're getting nothing. Mm-hmm. And people were like, not doing it or doing it poorly. So I added this little thing. I said, post tell me your favorite dessert.
Right.
And like, they tell you to do that stuff, and I thought it was a little corny, and everybody's like, well, I think this is really stupid, but, and then they write like three sentences about themselves and 10 sentences about the dessert because they go into the history, and it does seem to work, even though people kind of poo-poo it.
Okay.
It's effective.
Interesting. Okay, good. Anyone else want to share?
I don't like them.
Okay.
You didn't do icebreaker?
I didn't. For the school, I was like, come on, let's go learn. But I guess for me, whenever I had to do it, I don't tend to still remember who it was that I had to do the icebreaker with. You know, sometimes it's not any kind of like follow-up to it. So it's like this one time, I have to learn 30 people's names, and then I don't have to reference them again. So it's one of those kind of, I have a disconnect, and there's a disconnect.
Okay,
I hated the two truths and one.
Oh, yeah.
I hated that one.
Wait, which was this one?
The two truths and a lie.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They have those now on groupers. This is like a dating website thing where they set you and your friends up with some other people, and they have the two truths and a lie to facilitate talking. But it may not work that well.
As a complete side note, if you're ever curious, they did an NPR. I'm a big This American Life fan, and they did a big NPR story about the algorithms used for those matchmaking online programs. And someone who was actually, I think, a professor who wanted to find someone and decided that she needed to hack the system, or at least understand the system enough to find the person she was looking for, because apparently when she just entered her information, it never came up with any good matches. And so she determined what the algorithm was. And anyway, complete side note.
Okay. All right, so I'm hearing a theme in your responses, which is that these activities are not very popular, not very enjoyable. It's, you know, it can be kind of painful even to try to, it becomes almost like pulling teeth. And, you know, it really shouldn't be this awkward. I have this little gif here from Mean Girls, the movie, when Tina Fey says, well, this has been sufficiently awkward. And she's the teacher in this case, kind of just meeting up casually with the students in the mall. And it really shouldn't be this way. And we have the tools, we have the scientific methods that we can come up with something better. So the fast friends is this answer to our search for a, you know, perhaps a good method to get people talking. And it's stemming from decades of research on interpersonal communication and intimacy. So this is the title of the paper, Experimental Generation of Interpersonal Closeness. And one of the main differences between the fast friends and other icebreaker activities is that you're splitting people up into pairs or small groups. And, you know, I tell students, if you want to work in a group of three, that's totally fine. More than three in this short amount of a time period we're working with, it's tough to get good responses from everyone in the group. But the procedure is designed to take 45 minutes. And the goal originally for, you know, Art Aaron and relationships researchers in general is to study the process of how intimacy unfolds. And sure enough, we can get something that approximates friendship in a 45-minute time frame. The procedure itself is split up into three sets of questions. You have on your handouts in front of you set number one. So this would ordinarily take about 15 minutes. We're going to do it in 10, just as an exercise. And the other key difference between the fast friends procedure and other icebreakers is that we're really getting at deep questions about people. We're getting them to really open up about themselves, not just, you know, their guilty pleasure, favorite dessert, favorite TV show, whatever. We're getting them to answer questions like, you know, whose death would you be most upset about? And we're building on these principles from the psychology of communication and intimacy. I have them listed up here, that developing closeness and intimacy works over time, meaning it's sustained. And so you don't ask one or two questions. you keep going. You ask more. You ask follow-ups. There's a give and a response as well. It's also escalating in terms of its depth. So one researcher from the 1970s made this analogy between communication and the peeling of an onion, where you progressively get deeper and deeper in terms of the layers as you start peeling off. It's reciprocal, meaning it's not just I'm going to talk about myself and you're going to listen, but we're each going to listen to each other and we're going to respond and we're on an equal playing field. And the fourth is that it's personalistic. So this is what I meant before when I mentioned deep questions, that we're asking people about things that are very deeply meaningful to them as a person. I'm just going to give you a couple of examples here from each of the three sets, and then we'll do the set number one. So you'll each pair up and answer the questions with each other. So the set one questions contain, given the choice of anyone in the world, whom would you want as a dinner guest? Before making a telephone call, do you rehearse what you're going to say? Why? I love this question. Because I always rehearse what I'm going to say. And name three things that you and your partner appear to have in common. So one thing I want you to notice in all of these three sets is that not only are people answering questions about themselves and asking questions about their partner, but they're also thinking about the ways in which their friendship might be formed. So one thing is to look at commonalities. In set number two, we have, is there something you've dreamed of doing for a long time? Why haven't you done it? What is your most treasured or terrible memory? And what do you value most in a friendship? So here again, we're focusing on this theme of, if you're going to be friends, what does friendship mean to you? And everyone's got an opinion about friendship. These are easy questions for people to answer. Set number three, we're getting progressively deeper here in terms of the questions. Your house containing everything you own catches fire. After saving your loved ones and pets, you have time to safely make a final dash to save any one item. What would it be and why? And then if you're going to become a close friend with your partner, please share what would be important for him or her to know. So we're focusing on these really intimate questions here. And I want to break now so we can pair up and do this activity. So find the person closest sitting to you who is a stranger, someone you don't know, and pair up and ask each other these questions on the handout. We'll go for just about 10 minutes and then we'll talk about it. All right, everyone. So even if you're not done with the set of questions, let's come back as a group now. And I'm just curious to know what your thoughts are, what your experience is with these questions.
We didn't get through them.
Why not?
We were too busy talking about composting.
So this is something that my students will tell me all the time. They can't finish the questions in the time period that we give them. And that is a great thing, because it means you ask the question and then you go off on tangents and you're really comfortable and relaxed speaking to each other about a lot of different things. Sometimes you have these dead end questions like, oh, okay, what's your hometown? What's your favorite sport? And then it just ends there. Whereas with this type of procedure, you can kind of go off in all kinds of directions. Even if you only get to one or two of the items here, we've accomplished our goal. What else do you notice?
You would have thought that we were friends from the get-go because we were agreeable on a lot of the questions as far as what we were grateful for and
yeah.
Types of people that we would have lunch with and may not have been the same name, but it was the same concept. We wanted to have lunch with somebody that was fun.
That's great.
So.
That's great. Good. Any other thoughts or reactions?
We interpret the term partner differently.
Okay. So you thought of it more as like a significant other rather than the activity partner?
She thought of the significant other. I thought of the activity partner.
Okay.
It took us 2 minutes to figure out we were talking about different people.
Well, I mean, it...
And then it did become evident.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. The whole... we came up with female academic, and she's like, oh, your partner's a female, you know. I'm like, wow, she sounds good. That's interesting. I said, did you guys have the same childhood? And she starts looking at me like, how would I know?
That's great. That's great. So yeah, the partner in this case is the person you're doing the activity with, but certainly, you know, everyone's encouraged and feel free to talk about significant others or close friends or anyone else. All right. So I want to contrast, you know, the way this experiment was originally done. They had groups of people come in for the study, and they, by a process of random assignments, categorized people into this procedure or a small talk procedure. And so this is our control condition. So in any kind of life science or behavioral science, you'll see the researchers will do this. They'll say, okay, you're in group A, you're in group B, and randomly assign people to those groups. So our control condition, they're answering these types of questions, like where are you from, name all the places you've lived, what did you do this summer, if you could invent a new flavor of ice cream, what would it be, and what gifts did you receive last holiday? So again, these are the types of, you know, standard questions we would ordinarily see in the icebreakers that we've all said we don't really like that much. And after doing these questionnaires, then afterwards, the researchers will ask people, you know, think about how close you are to your activity partner using this overlapping circles diagram. So this is called the inclusion of other in the self scale. And it is a measure of closeness that has been validated with studies of long-term relationship and friendship partners. And basically, you describe what you believe is the most accurate picture of the amount of overlap you perceive between yourself and that other person on a 1 to 7 scale. So we actually get numbers here based on these pictorial diagrams. In the results from the original study from the late 90s, there was a significant difference between the small talk control condition here on the left and the fast friends procedure here in the middle. And, you know, for those of you who are thinking, well, it looks like less than a point difference on the scale, this is actually a large effect. If there are any stats gurus in the audience, we have a Cohen's D of 0.88, which is a large effect. And if you look at it relative to what we know about the average close friendship in real life, that's going to be here on the right. So when people are asked to describe how close they are with their actual real friends, it's less than the difference we see for the difference between the small talk and the fast friends. So when Dr. Aaron was asked, are we creating real friendships here? He said the answer is yes and no. Yes, we are creating real friendships in the sense that they are closer and more intimate than we would see with the small talk, not as close as people would have with their best friends and family that they've known for years, but still closer to that than we would otherwise be. Now, what about personality differences? If you're thinking, well, you know, maybe there are some people who are particularly shy and introverted, would they do just as well with this kind of task? And the answer is, when we just do the regular fast friends procedure with no additional instructions, we do see a difference based on introversion. So people who are more extroverted, who are outgoing, they tend to become closer than the introverts. But when we specifically make closeness a goal for the task, when we say your task here is to make a friend and become close to them, then we see no difference between introverts and extroverts. So just adding that little extra piece of information seems to do quite well. These are pieces of feedback that I consistently get from students after we do this procedure, and we've gotten some similar feedback from you all after doing just 10 minutes of it. Ordinarily, you'd be doing the procedure for the full 45 minutes, and that takes, you know, basically one class period to do. But students consistently say they really enjoy doing the activity. It's fun, and they've made a new friend, which feels really good. They also expressed that they're pleasantly surprised at how easy it was to talk to someone that they've never encountered before, especially about these very deep personal things. Some students will note that it seems like they're you know, with someone that they would have met on a plane or a train ride, someone that they would ordinarily be a stranger, but they strike up a conversation and it feels really good and they feel comfortable knowing that this person isn't going to hurt them with any kind of information, like, you know, strangers on a plane type of environment. Also, and this is something that you noted, people say they're really struck by how much similarity they perceived between themselves and their activity partner. And this is one of the most important things that students can learn, because very often they'll come into class, they'll come into school with preconceived notions of who people are just based on appearance and stereotypes and prejudices that can occur. And so we really dispel these, you know, potentially harmful stereotypes by saying, look, you guys have a lot more in common than you think. And people walk away from this thinking, I'm going to think twice about making initial judgments about people based on this experience, because maybe I have a lot more in common with them than I previously thought. Students also note that the procedure itself is really kind of a social norm violation. We don't do this kind of thing with everyday folks in our activities in our daily life. And just the idea that you would approach a stranger and ask them intimate questions is not something that we would ordinarily do, but it feels good. And students are often musing about this and surprised by that. Like, why do we have this social norm? Why do we have small talk at all? Why do people talk about the weather so much, if this is the kind of thing that we would prefer? And this is where I tell people, okay, well, you need to get out there and start creating new social norms. Start taking this wherever you go. Yes?
I think it's very good, but would it be also like such kind of questions, would that sort of more deeper questions be offensive to someone who's, would that be a problem?
Yes, so let me address this on the next slide, actually, because I want to say a little bit more about that. First, I'll just say a couple of things that some students, and this is, I think, one of the most profound realizations that students have made in my class, which is, they don't even know what their close friends and family would answer to some of these questions, to most of these questions, because they've never gotten that deep, even with the most intimate people in their lives. So if we go back to this inclusion of other in the self scale, just, you know, to put this with a frame of reference, in the small talk condition, people are rating themselves about a 3.25. So that would be up here. I have the pointer, but for some reason, you can't really see it. So we're looking at about a 3.25. For the fast friends, we're looking at about a 4. So we're looking at about that much overlap. And then for the real friends, it's somewhere between a 4 and a 5. 4.65 is kind of about here. So generally speaking, on average, people even with their closest, most intimate relationship partners are not up here. And that's notable because it suggests that we do have these gaps between us and our significant others that we weren't necessarily aware of before doing this procedure. And, you know, some of my students tell me, like, I'm going to go do this with my friends and family next week. And I had one student say, I'm going to take this on a date. And I'm going to use it when I go out with someone I want to get to know them. And I said, that's a great idea. Well done. And then students will say, yes, we need to be doing more of this. And you know, one student said that this semester, actually, they've seen this procedure used in a bunch of their classes. And I was very happy to see that other instructors at the university are using this procedure to get their semesters going. So let me say a little bit more about the question you raised and general concerns that people might have before using this procedure. So, again, we're kind of socialized in this way that we're tending to avoid potentially sensitive, embarrassing, controversial topics. Don't talk about politics and religion is a common refrain in our society. And, you know, certainly we want to, you know, have a safe and comfortable environment for our students. And there's also this norm, regardless of the content of what you're doing in terms of the conversation, you don't want to jump right into a deep conversation about any topic with someone that you just met, because that's not the norm. And also, just this, you know, this sign I found in New York City in the subway, Don't smile at strangers. We're constantly being reminded of this. However, again, I want to emphasize these are statistical findings that we have and certainly don't apply to everyone. There might be one or two students in a class of 150 that really don't like this, but most of us love it. Most of the time, people really like big talk. Small talk, not so much. Tall talk, that's the kind of stuff that's really meaty and juicy that we really like to get into. And people do enjoy this type of thing with total strangers. There was a great study that came out recently. This was just a month ago, actually, in the Journal of Experimental Psychology, where they asked people to report on conversations they would have with strangers during their commute on the train. I believe they did this study in Boston. And they were just keeping track of the kinds of expectations people had and the kind of experiences they would have just striking up a conversation with a random stranger in the subway. And it turns out that, you know, the study shows confirming evidence from other studies as well that we really like this kind of thing. That simply sitting alone with our, you know, iPad or with a newspaper is not as enjoyable as striking up a conversation with someone and getting to know them, even if you're never going to see them again. So this was a quote from an article describing this research on the Huffington Post. Even though people think that talking to a stranger during their commute will be a negative experience, they actually report greater well-being after doing so. So their emotional health is actually enhanced by these kinds of interactions, despite the assumption that other people don't want to talk to us. This is kind of the huge disconnect that we see in social psychology, this pluralistic ignorance. Everyone assumes the norm is something different from what they personally believe is true. So everyone collectively believes that it's not good to interact with strangers in a meaningful way, even though, on average, most of us really enjoy it. So that's my best answer to try to address people's concerns, which I think are valid, especially given the culture that we live in. It's also important to note that Americans tend to be a little more cold and distant than people in other cultures. A lot of my friends and colleagues from South America, from Europe, they describe, you know, the way they'll engage with people and the way they'll even stand much closer to each other. My former lab mate from Brazil would come up and stand like right here, and I'd be like, okay, you know, just backing up a little bit. And she said, oh, you Americans are so cold. And she was right. And we can be a little weird in this way, but in general, still, even Americans will enjoy this kind of thing. So, in conclusion, if there's one thing that I think is the most essential point to take home from this, it's that humans are ultra-social creatures. We are, as John Haidt said, 90% chimp and 10% bee. We have these, you know, tendencies to form hive-ish communities where we're always communicating and interacting with anonymous strangers, whether it's, you know, at the checkout line or in the classroom, and getting to know the person sitting next to you feels really good. So, again, I hope that you will all take this and use it in your personal lives, in your professional lives, tell other people about it. And, you know, of course, I'm happy to talk more about it. And if you have any questions, then let's do that now. Yeah.
I have a question. Okay, sure. So I can usually do pretty good the first time around. But if you get really close to somebody and you see them again, and I wondered if your students had the same experience having to go to class, then how do you keep this up? Because it establishes kind of a higher level of intimacy than you would normally achieve.
Sure. So our goal now is to do what?
I'm just curious if they feel like with their partner, they have this exercise. Do they feel awkward then the second time they see them than the first time they see them?
Do
they maintain that throughout the
semester? I've heard the opposite. I've heard that students actually stay friends with their activity partner even after the semester ends. Some people paired up for the study told me that they were dating And some people kept in touch, but you know, by Facebook. Some people kept in touch in future classes of theirs. They became group members, and it was based on that initial communication they had in the previous class.
So this is like they're partners all through the semester.
Well, no, in this case, we're just having the activity be the, you know, a fun thing that they're doing at the beginning of the semester that's not related to anything else they're going to be doing necessarily. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Did they do anything with like age? Did they see if age mattered at all this study, or is it mostly just students?
Yeah, so I believe in the original study, they were basically just college students. I haven't seen any differences based on age, although these basic findings have been replicated in other samples that are non-college students. So community samples, they found similar effects. Yeah?
I have a logistic question.
Sure.
I want to do this on the first day, and I have to hit the syllabus too. Can I cut it down from 45 minutes to like 30? Would that be effective?
Just say it.
I want to say yes, but as a scientist, I always have to look at the data. And the data are derived from activities that last 45 minutes. So maybe. And you know, you might do, if you only have a half hour, you might get a good result. But
the reason I say that is I co-teach, and I'm not sure I can convince my co-teacher to give up two class periods.
So the other thing, the other suggestion that I have is to assign students to do this in their spare time. Say, okay, we have this procedure, go grab a cup of coffee or something, and you know, do it with one other person. And to check that they've done it, you can, you know, maybe have them write a little paragraph reaction and just submit it, even if it's not for a grade. And that way they have the full 45 minutes and you don't have to take up more class time than you otherwise would.
I'm okay taking an entire class period or two, but again, I've got a co-teacher, and so I'm not sure. He lets me do my active learning thing, and he lectures, so it works out. But,
gotcha.
Anyway. So, because I, like I said, I have a problem with my students sitting next to the same person all semester, and it gets towards the final, and I say, why are you studying with so-and-so? You sit next to them all the time. They're like, who? So, that's why I wanted to try it.
Right, right. Good, good. Other thoughts or questions? One other thing that I forgot to mention, and you can play around with this as necessary, but I think it's cool to kind of prime students to think about self-disclosure by showing them a brief video. And there's a couple of clips that you can get on YouTube or Vimeo, which is kind of like YouTube except higher quality video capture. And basically, they're just showing people meeting as strangers and disclosing things about themselves in a procedure that's remarkably similar to this one. So this is called Take a Seat, Make a Friend, and we can watch it now. It's not that long. And then the other one is actually a video from the makers of Post Secret. So for those of you who know what Post Secret is, it's this anonymous confessions page actually run by a Maryland resident, someone who came to College Park, I think it was last year or the year before, and gave a presentation here. Anyway, it's a very, very popular website. And they put together a video which I think is one of the most beautiful, inspiring videos ever created, where people are just describing these intimate secrets about themselves on camera. And that gets students in the mindset of, okay, that this is the norm. We're all opening up here. So let me show you this video real quick. It's only a few minutes long.
Drowning or being underwater or getting attacked by an octopus or any of those things. want to learn curling. Like that Winter Olympics sport.
Oh, alright, we just slide the.
Yeah, and then it's like bowling and swimming.
Find one thing you have in common. Do you play sports?
Not currently. I play soccer, so.
Soccer?
Yeah.
Alright.
Actually, I play the drums. Do you play any instruments?
I quit everything I ever tried.
Alright, actually, fun fact, these aren't real teeth. Yeah.
I have a flipper tooth.
Really?
Ah, oh my god! No! I can't wait.
What?
My front throat!
Oh my gosh.
You don't even understand. I swear to god, I feel like someone's planted us here for this reason.
Jessica, describe the first time you fell in love.
Oh, I think it was kindergarten. I don't remember his name. He was beautiful.
I was in the Navy.
You were in the Navy?
And my husband was in the Navy. Long story short, before he ever kissed me or we were ever really together, he told me he loved me. 24 years later, we're more in love and we're better friends than even from the very beginning.
That's true love and it's fun.
Yeah.
Talk about someone who inspires you.
Is it all right to talk about somebody that's a religious character?
Yeah, why not? This is our ballpark. We can talk about whoever we want, right?
Jesus.
All right.
Just my peers. They're all creative in their own ways and have their own realities and own lessons. I just grow from everybody else's as well as my own.
Martin Luther King, I think, because the fact that we're sitting in this box together is a big deal. You know?
You know who inspires me, believe it or not, is my daughter. She is
aww,
everything I ever wanted to be.
All right. Talk about the experience that changed your life. Oh, that's a good one. Mm. After my wife decided that it was time that we split, I started to have a different perspective on life. I saw women differently. I saw relationships differently. I think I became more appreciative of women.
How old do you say you are?
20?
Yeah. Okay. At the age of 21, I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, and it pulled the rug out from all my plans. It really changes the way you look at things.
Mm-hmm. My grandmother has it.
Who does?
My grandmother.
There's our common.
We found the common.
We found the common.
That's why I was still here. We found the common.
Oh, create a secret handshake.
Ooh.
Okay. Okay. Nothing was spent.
All right, so, and this goes to show you, I think those are good examples of the kinds of experiences people have when they do this activity. So showing them this video will kind of get them in the right mindset for self-disclosure. I think it's also, you know, I didn't mention this before, but I think it's also important to remember, to emphasize that the object of this is to have fun. And if there's any particular question that they don't want to answer, we have dozens of them. So just skip right over it, go to the next one. And you know, the last thing we want to do is make people feel uncomfortable. Some students will try to approach me during class and they're wondering if they're doing this activity correctly. And I say, there's no right or wrong way to do this. Just have fun. Just ask each other the questions. You don't have to write down yours or your partner's or whatever. Just, you know, that's the goal here, is to make a new friend. Get them as relaxed as possible, and you've done it.